This is the hour of grace.
God has nailed every curse on the cross for you. The snare is broken.
Hour of Grace with Pastor Sunny Owego. Tune in for more expository, reviving, and refreshing word from the throne of grace. Hour of Grace, transforming lives.
This is the hour of grace.
I'll be taking the message titled Kingdom Stewards and Outcasts. Kingdom Stewards and Outcasts. And the text will be from Luke chapter 19, verse 11 to 27. Luke 19, verse 11 to 27. And as they heard these things, he added and spake a parable because he was near to Jerusalem. And because they thought that the kingdom of God should immediately appear. Jesus had just left Jericho. Jesus had just left the house of Zacchaeus in Jericho, and he was heading to Jerusalem, where he was going to keep faith with his eternal objective. He came to die, and he was going there. As Jesus was going, the Bible said that the people that were with him in that verse 11 we read, as they were approaching Jerusalem, they thought that the kingdom of God should immediately appear. And it has been their thought all through the lifetime of Jesus. The Jews had always hoped that Jesus as Messiah had come to deliver them from the oppressive rule of the Roman Empire, because Israel was occupied by Rome. So they were thinking as Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, that was what was going to happen. So you can imagine two expectations. Jesus was coming to meet with faith while he came on earth. The people around him were thinking he was coming for an earthly kingdom to give them an earthly freedom, political freedom. That was the scenario. And as Jesus knew what was going through their mind, Jesus decided to give them this parable in order to use a historical event that they were familiar with to pass on an important message that he will want them to appreciate. So he began to talk about this parable. I want to make case to say that in this parable, everyone under the sun is represented. Everyone under the sun. And Jesus is the Lord and Master in this parable. There are three sets of people under two groups. Three sets of people under two groups. The first set we can see in verse 14. And those were the enemies of Jesus. Unbelievers. They represent the unbelievers. Those that said, we will not have this man reign over us. But it's interesting to know that in that same verse 14, the Bible called those people his citizens. The Bible said his citizens hated him. In other words, they were his citizens. As long as you are in this world, you are his citizen, because he's the creator of the world and he's the creator of everyone that is in the world. It does not matter whether you like him or not. It does not matter whether you hate him or not. You may reject him as much as you want. You may refuse to accept the gospel. You may decide to choose anything you want to believe in. And you say you don't believe in Jesus. The truth is that as long as you have breath in you, he created you. And you are a citizen in the world that he created. So at the end of the day, you will be answerable to him. The book of Colossians chapter 1 verse 15 to 17 made it clear. Colossians chapter 1. Verse 15 to 17. That scripture tells us that he was the one that created everything that was created, and there was nothing that was created that he did not create. And by him and through him all things consist. So he is your creator. No matter what you choose to believe, he will remain your creator. So we can see in that first set, those that said we will not have this man reign over us, but they were obvious about it. They didn't pretend. They didn't hide their hatred for the Lord. They made it clear. But in Philippians chapter 2, verse 10 and 11, Philippians 2, 10 and 11, the Bible makes it clear too that at the end of the day, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord. So all those that are saying today that they don't believe in him, they will confess him as Lord. Unfortunately, for most of them, it will have been too late. Or for all of them, those that refuse to believe in him, even Satan will bow, even Satan will confess, yet he will end up in hell. So this is the only time for you to believe in him and accept him. This is the only time for you to find salvation. Because the Bible says it is appointed unto man once to die, after that the judgment. Hebrews 9:27. It's appointed unto man once to die, after that the judgment. So whether you believe in him or not, I want you to bear that in mind. Now the second set, you will find in verse 16 and in verse 18, the second set. These are the faithful stewards. The faithful stewards are the ones represented in 16, 18 of that Luke chapter 19. We saw in verse 16, the first servant came to the master and presented the £1 given to him. He said, your pound has earned 10 pounds. Your pound had earned 10 pounds. And we saw that the master, the Lord, he acknowledged that it was the Lord's pound that earned the 10 pounds that he was presenting. He was humble about it, and he did not take the glory. He returned all the glory to the Lord. And in this verse following, we saw how the Lord responded. By the way, what that first servant did was to make 1,000% profit from what the Lord gave to him. Remember that the Lord gave everyone, 10 servants, he gave each of them a pound. The 10 servants represent all the believers in this world. Everyone that believes in the Lord is represented among those 10 servants. But when the Lord came and he was taking account, he only chose 3 among those 10 servants. The 3 servants he chose, they represent all the rest. Because every other servant will fall into one of those categories of 3. The first servant, the second, and then the other one. So the first servant gave account and made 1,000% profit. The Lord commended him. Say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Because you have done this, I give you 10 cities. By the way, he left the 10 talents with him. He did not take it. He was not interested in the talent. He gave him 10 cities. Say, take charge of 10 cities because you've been faithful in little. When God gives you a little, what you do with that little will determine what God will do with you later on. If you are faithful in little things, God can now commit into your hands greater things. If you cannot handle little things, then you will have nothing to ever handle. And we are talking about eternity. Forever and ever and ever. That is not the place you will get to, and you will have nothing to present before your master. Then we saw the second servant. Even among this second set, the second servant, in verse 18, the second servant returned to the master 5 pounds. Remember, the master gave him 1 pound. He returned 5 pounds. That was 500% profit. The master, the Lord, told him, have charge, authority over 5 cities. The second servant, just like the first servant, also acknowledged that it was the lost pound that earned the 5 pounds. He did not take glory in it, and he returned all the glory to the Lord. The Lord gave him 5 cities, but if you note, the Lord did not commend him like he commended the first servant. The first servant received commendation and reward. The second servant received reward, but without commendation. The Lord knows what you have and what you can do with it. If you look at that scripture, where the Lord distributed all these things to them, particularly in verse 13, he said, occupy till I come. That's how it is translated in the King James Version. But in the New King James Version, he said, do business until I come. So what the Lord was invariably telling everyone that he has saved, every believer, you should do business with the gospel that has transformed your life until he comes. And the word business is taken from the Greek word pragma. Pragma in Greek is from what, where we got the word in English, pragmatic. So the Lord is telling you to be pragmatic with what he has given to you. Be flexible, be innovative, be resourceful. Think of what to do with what God has given to you so that you can make profit. And there is no saying how much profit you can make with what God has given to you. I've mentioned about the Hebrides sisters, 2 sisters. They're in their 80s. This was somewhere in Scotland. They were old. They were so old. One was blind. One was, you know, could not move because of arthritis, serious arthritis. What did they do? They gave themselves to prayer. They were praying seriously. And they prayed down the Hebrides revival. Though they could not move, but they knew they could do something. This woman prayed so much so that bars closed, clubs closed. The police became almost idle because there were no more criminals in town. The prison became empty. 2 women that were considered as invalids, they used what they had. At least they had breath in them, and they could talk to heaven, and they did exactly that. So please don't tell me that you can't do something. You can do something if you want to. God has given you resources that if you are pragmatic with it, if you're resourceful and innovative, you can utilize and you can gain so much from that. But the Lord rewarded him all the same. He gave him 5 cities. Then we move down to verse 20. When we got to verse 20, it's as if the scene had changed. We saw something different. In verse 20, we saw something different. We noticed a drastic change. Because they said there, then another came. They didn't tell us the third servant came. You saw how they have been telling us the first servant came, the second servant came. Then in this situation, they didn't say the third servant, they said then another. That means a different type of servant. Then another kind of servant appeared. And this is a servant I will call a labeled believer. A believer who is a believer only on level. And we have so many such believers in the church. They profess to be believers just in name. Remember when he came, he also called the master Lord. He called him Lord. But what he said next will show you that the master was not his Lord. What he said next will show you there was no relationship between them. No wonder Jesus said, many will come and say, Lord, Lord, and I will tell them, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity. I knew you not. I knew you not. In other words, when you were busy calling me Lord, Lord, there was no relationship between us. He told the Lord, here, take your pound. I wrapped it for you and kept in a napkin. Take it. Because I'm afraid of you. You are not steerman. A man who takes what he didn't keep. A man who reaps where he did not sow. What? What a scandalous thing to say. If Jesus is truly your Lord, you will worship him in truth and in spirit. Of course, this man was a hypocrite. He was a false steward. He was a pretender. He was not a faithful steward. He had no relationship with Christ. He definitely will fall in that group that the Lord will say, depart from me, I knew you not. Matthew chapter 7, verse 23. Matthew 7, 23. So we could see that this man was rebellious. The Lord's command was, do business till I come, occupy till I come. He was disobedient to the master. He was rebellious. And remember that the master himself has said, if you love me, obey my commandment. So it is through the obedience to his commandment that he will know whether you love him or not. John chapter 14 verse 15. John chapter 14 verse 15. If you love me, obey my commandment. So this man, we could see, called the Lord an austere man. He said the Lord was austere, which means to be severe, harsh, unfair, exacting, ungracious, strict. All these things, if you look at them, they are nothing reflective of the person and character of the Lord. Even from the account we've seen so far, the Lord in this story gave a man that brought 10 pounds, 10 cities. Is there a comparison between 10 pounds and 10 cities? 5 pounds, 5 cities. And he left the pounds they brought with them. He didn't take their pounds. He was not interested in their resources. Let me tell you, God is not interested in your resources. When God is telling you to do anything for him, it is not because he has a personal benefit. It is for your benefit. It is for my benefit. So this man said that the Lord was an austere man, that the Lord reaps where he did not sow, where he didn't sow, that he will take what he didn't keep. In, you see, this man effectively was saying that the Lord was a thief. What a blasphemous thing to say. And he was saying it publicly, openly. You can identify people like that even in the church. When they talk with some brazen impunity. They say things that angels will be afraid to utter, but they don't care. You can see, you know, such people. The type of things they say. They tell you they don't fear anybody. They can say anything. That was this type of man. Pretenders, they pretend to be believers, but they're hypocrites. They are false. They are not saved. They think they are saved, but they are unsaved. They assume they are saved, but they are unsaved. We saw their type in the person of Judas. Judas was like this man, a labeled believer. They will say, oh, see the disciple of Jesus. But that was just in name. In content and character, he was different. There are many believers in the church today that are like that. In content and character, they are different. You can't even recognize them. They will come and tell you fanciful stories. You say, hey, my brother is in need. My sister, you carry money and give them. They say, ah, before the end of month, I will come and give you that money. The moment they collect your money, they disappear. You say, hey, in the church, I didn't know we have 419 in the church. Oh. False believers, pretenders, hypocrites, labeled believers. The Lord, when he took that money from him, after the man had finished talking, how did the Lord respond to him? The Lord called him a wicked servant. A wicked servant. That was how the Lord described him. It means an evil and worthless person. Evil and worthless. Let me tell you, the Lord will never describe any of his children as evil and worthless. Go through the scriptures. All the people the Lord will call wicked are those that are doomed and damned. So that shows you where that man was going. That man went where those that say we will not have this man reign over us. Where they went will be where this other one will go. It is as simple as that. Evil and worthless. You are busy occupying space in my house, but you are not of me. I didn't know you. We had no relationship. You are busy parading yourself to be one of my children, but you were not. You were false. You were a hypocrite. I pray none of us should fall into that category. I pray none of us should fall there. Let me tell you, there is nobody that we say the Lord has not given him something to do business with in the kingdom of God. Nobody, nobody. No matter who you are. If somebody that cannot move, if somebody that cannot see, could pray and still do business for the master, how much more you? Don't tell me you don't have money. Even when you don't have money, you can be resourceful. That man was condemned by the Lord. And that was how he lost out. The Lord took his 1 pound and gave to the man that had 10 pounds already. In the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 9, 1 Corinthians 2, 9. The Bible said the eyes have not seen, your heart cannot even think, your ear has not heard what the Lord has prepared for you because he loves you. He has so much he has prepared for you. So whatever you're doing now will go with great reward. So it became obvious that that man hated the Lord without a cause. He hated the Lord without a cause. And the Bible makes it clear in the book of John chapter 15 verse 25. Jesus himself said it, they hated me without a cause. John chapter 15 verse 25. John 15, 25. They hated me without a cause. I pray you will not be among those that will hate the Lord without a cause. When you refuse to obey him, it means you do not love him. And if you don't love him, it means you hate him. It's as simple as that. Because like we have seen, if you love me, obey my commandment. So if you don't obey his commandment, it means you don't love him. And Jesus said, they hated me without a cause. If he came and gave his life for us, if he came and gave his all for us, why should we not love him back? I pray that no matter where you are, who you are, as you hear this word, you will take an informed decision. Whether you are one of those that say, I don't recognize him, I don't believe him, I've told you that he is your creator. I've told you are living in the world that he created. I've told you a day will come when you will bow your knees, when your tongue will confess him as Lord, whether you like it or not. But let it not be when after you've done that, you will be damned. You had better do it now so that you can be saved. Let's please rise on our feet to pray.
You are not born again? Say this prayer. Lord Jesus, come into my life. I accept you as my Lord and Savior. I believe in my heart that you died and rose from the dead to save me. Right with my mouth, I declare you Lord over my life. Thank you, Father, for saving me. In Jesus' name, Amen. If you want us to pray or counsel you, please call. You can visit us at the Redeemed Christian Church of God, Shepherd's Hill, 54 NTA Choba Road, Ngoba, Port Harcourt. Thank you for watching.